The Andaman Nicobar Islands are at a distance of 1190 kilometers from Chennai and 1250 kilometers from Calcutta and 1000 kilometers from New Delhi.
Until the late 18th century, the Andamanese culture, language and genetics were preserved from outside influences by their fierce reaction to visitors, which include killing any shipwrecked foreigners and by the remoteness of the islands. The various tribes and their mutually unintelligible languages thus are believed to have evolved on their own over a millennia. A clear history of the Andaman and Nicobar Islands can be had only from a British survey of these islands conducted in 1777. The Andaman Nicobar Islands remained the abode of the Negritos and the Mongoloid respectively, who occupied the islands for centuries. These islands remained secluded from the mainland till the end of the 18th century, when people from the outside world first arrived. The history of the Andaman and Nicobar Islands can be divided into three periods, such as the British regime, that is a period of foreign intrusion and settlement. Second one is Japanese regime. Third one is the post-independence period. The history of the British in the Andaman and Nicobar Islands began in 1788, when Lord Cornwallis, the then Governor General of India, thought of colonizing the islands and instructed Lieutenant Archibald Blair and Colebrook. The first settlements was found in 1789 on the Chatham Island. After the Great Revolt in 1857, the British government thought of establishing a penal settlement here. In March 1858, the first penal settlement was established with 200 prisoners, mostly rebels from the Indian Army. The foundation of the famous Cellular Jail was laid in 1896. The building was completed in 1906. World War II brought another series of changes in the life of the Andamans. During the war, the Japanese occupied Andamans on March 21, 1942. And kept the region under their effective control till October 8, 1945. The Andaman and Nicobar Islands, together with the rest of India, became independent on August 15, 1947. The Bengalis are the major population group which came to the Andamans after the independence. They came as the settlers under the government rehabilitation scheme, which started as early as 1949 and continued till the 1970s. All these groups migrated to the Andamans from Bangladesh. The Bengalis are primarily distributed in the different districts of the North, Middle and South Andamans. Others from different parts of mainland followed in 1970, 1974, 1977, 1979 and 1980. These settlers include, among others, such as Punjabis, Marathis, Malayalis, Telugu and Tamilians. In the second century, the Andaman and Nicobar Islands were located in the maps prepared by the Greek astronomer, mathematician and geographer Claudius Ptolemaeus, which possibly is the earliest reference to these islands. The early history of the Nicobar is not well known, although these islands were familiar to traders in ancient times, the islands being situated close to the trade route to the Far East. Though little is known about Portuguese activities in these islands, it is evident that the Portuguese missionaries started preaching Christianity among the islanders. The Nicobarese language also reflects a few Portuguese words. F.J. Mount, in his work The Andaman Islanders, published in 1863, gives a general description of the different islands encounters with the tribals, and expedition notes. Apart from this, he has given a detailed description of the characteristic features of the tribals. While writing, he mentions that in these islands, man was probably still in the same condition in which he was when they were first settled, simple and primitive. Their language was barely sufficient for the expression of their few simple wants. Totally ignorant of agriculture, they have no means of making provision for the future and must be satisfied with fruits and herbs, and as they spontaneously produce, and which the shellfishes they pick up and on the shore. Their habitation are of that simple construction and constantly moving from place to place.
History of our relations with the Andamanese is one of the important documents which has prepared by M.E. Portman. This is a basic report which you can observe here. He has talked about the Great Andamanes, Wongis, and the Champlains of Great Nicobar Island also.
Portman, in his work, given information on various expeditions which he has made and official instructions, history, and a brief account of traditional norms, behavior, and the settlements of the tribes in Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Portman extensively worked among the South Andaman group of tribes, especially Great Andamanese tribes.
Edward Harris Mann is one of the important ethnographer who has written on the tribes of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Here you can see the Edward Harris Mann, first published in 1883. Its title is The Aboriginal Inhabitants of Andaman Islands. Here he has given a detailed account of these tribals ethnography. That is, you know, he has given about the magic and witchcraft, which is very important to know, the tribal distribution and the tribal community, the nomadism, habitation and adoption relationships, the hunting and fishing ways and warfare.
Baron Klaas visited Andaman and Nicobar Islands in the year 1901. He has written a document in the Andaman and Nicobars, where he has given the description of the flora, fauna, and ethnology of the Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Alfred Radcliffe Brown published a book, The Andaman Islanders, in 1922. This book was based upon fieldwork carried out by Radcliffe Brown in the Andaman Islands during the years 1906 to 1908. The text contains detailed information on various aspects of the indigenous cultures found in these islands, with analysis of social organization, ceremonial customs, myths, legends, and religious beliefs. Illustrative figures are incorporated throughout, including numerous photographs and appendices are provided on language and technology. This book will be value to anyone with an interest in Radcliffe Brown, the Andaman Islands, and the development of anthropology.
31, which has been prepared by M.C.C. Bonington. He is one of the British administrator, worked as a superintendent of census operation. His work, which is published in 1932, which became a basic book for all the anthropologists.
M.V. Portman has documented on Andamanese languages, and his book Manual of the Andaman Languages, very important one. The Census of India 1921 by Lewis gives us the statistical figures and also the flora fauna of Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Suresh Vaidya has given an important document entitled as The Islands of the Marigold Sun. The Land and the People of Andamans by Sain is an important book which gives us the details of geographical and socio-economical conditions of the Andaman Islands. The most important works on Andaman Islands are Bonington 1932, Lewis 1932, Das 1937, Changappa 1951, Sen in 1962, Cipriani in 1966, Pandit 1975, Chakravarti 1977, Datta 1974, and Naidu 1994.
It has been reported that the Jarwa was the first tribe which became friendly with the Britishers in 1790, just after the start of the first penal settlement in the year 1788 and 89. The Jarwa was inhabiting the southern side of Andamans, presently the Port Blair. After the second penal settlement of 1858, the Jarwa enemy Great Andamanese became friendly with the Britishers. The Jarwa did not like the idea that the new settlers should be friendly with their enemy groups. The situation gave rise to a regular feeling of hostility among the Jarwa to outsiders. Actually, the partiality shown by the Britishers towards Jarwa tribe provoked the Jarwa, who became hostile. The Great Andamanese were even given firearms to slaughter the hostile Jarwa. They were given iron pieces and files to prepare arrows to be used against the Jarwa. The Jarwa got scared of the increasing strength of the Great Andamanese supported by the Britishers and migrated to the north. Besides the forest, which they had sheltered and sustained hunting and food gathering since time immemorial, were destroyed. It was in the year 1873 that the Jarwa made the first raid on a settlement. These raids continued up to 1996. The Bush Police, formed in October 1905, consists of 20 Andamanese. Two of them are armed with the guns and the remainder with the bows and arrows. They are usually stationed at the Port Blair home to be readied at short notice when required to hunt runaway convicts or any Jarwas who may molest convicts in the outskirts of the settlements. It has been mentioned that about 89 encounters took place with the Jarwa between 1946 and 1963. The non-Jarwa killed many Jarwa and the Jarwa killed 15 non-Jarwas. The formation of convict settlements in the areas possessed by the Jarwa for centuries gave a shock to them. Later on, other communities like the Cranes, Mapilas, Burmans, Bunds, and the Bengalis from Bangladesh also settled down in vast areas after clearing the forest. From March 1942 to October 1945, the Japanese forces did not even spare the jungle dwellers, who were aerially bombarded on the basis of some initial hostile encounters. The Jarwa should have felt that these aerial bombardments were aimed at exterminating them. It was observed that the degree of hostility of Jarwa towards outsiders has always increased, corresponding to the pressure on them shifting their existence. The fear, pressure, and forces of Aleutian people kept the Jarwa shifting from one region to another. In fact, they were living in southern part of South Andaman. Under compulsion, their movements started towards north to their original habitations. With the increasing activities like construction of the roads, settlements of villages, felling of the forest, etc., the Jarwa continued to raid the settlements of refugees and laborers engaged in road building. A road has facilitated further encroachment of non-tribals into Jarwa territory. Indiscriminate destruction of the forest on both sides of the road was done. The Jarwa are furious that the road is being laid in their territory because it has further reduced their area of foraging. This road called the Great Andaman Trunk Road, links the three main Andaman Islands, North, Middle and South, because of the interventions of the late Prime Minister Mrs. Indira Gandhi, the work on this road was stopped for some time, but it was completed in the year 1994. Since 1998, the Jarwa have started coming to the Kadamtala jetty during daytime. In the beginning, only few men used to come. Then they were not seen up to the end of November 1998. From December 1998, the frequency of Jarwa coming to the jetty has increased. While returning from jetty, they used to collect the banana from the settlers' gardens. In the same period, two other areas such as Tirur and Middle Strait also the Jarwa started coming. The Jarwas used to come to the villages to collect the coconuts and bananas. In the Middle Strait, the Jarwa are coming onto the Andaman Trunk Road, stopping the vehicles for collecting the food items and for travelling in the motor vehicles up to the jetty and Arke Nala. The young Jarwa boys used to cross the creek by swimming from the Gandhigad jetty to Uttara jetty and goes to the Baratang police station to get the cooked rice from them. The Jarwa, a small Negrito primitive hunting, fishing and gathering tribe, are under continuous exploitation since 1856. The establishment of the penal settlement by the British in 1857, followed by the establishment of the settlements for the convicts in 1947, the establishment of the refugee settlements from 1960 and the construction of the Andaman Trunk Road are the important threats faced by the Jarwa over a period of time, which finally led to the total extinction of the Jarwa tribe. Presently, the Jarwa are in disarray and no longer they are going to be isolated from the surrounding non-tribal populations. The story of Jarwa is one that has been repeated throughout the contemporary tribal world. A society that has lived in isolation for ages suddenly falters into the survival problem.
It is a God-given gift to me to do research on the Jarwa Aboriginal population in Andaman Islands. As an anthropologist, I feel proud that I am the only anthropologist in the world enjoyed such an intimate relationship with an alien population.
In recognizing the research work, the Andaman and Nicobar government given 1998 Independence Day Commendation Award to Professor T.S. Naidu. The conservation model and the findings of the research reports were provided to the concerned ministers and officials of the Government of India and to the Andaman and Nicobar Administration for conservation and development of the Jarwa tribe.